And yet there's no parking there whatsoever, is there? And, you know, we have an awful lot of problem in Knowsley by getting enforcement officers to keep the roads clear. So that's another thing. But other than that, it's excellent report. Thanks very much.
Comments on Winston Churchill?
I'm quite a repulsor. I think, if I may, I think the first point that was made is absolutely fundamental, I think, which is that it is really, really important that we're clear about what our priorities are for rail in the city region. We do need that information to take to those conversations on how we're trying to get the attention of TFM Central in relation to taking forward conversations to things like Northern Powerhouse Rail. But most definitely the things like where we're trying to pursue funding for stations such as the Liverpool Central Station, that's absolutely the right thing for us to do. And so having something that allows us to present that and have a accessible conversation that's not kind of sourced from several different sort of areas and different documents and so on is absolutely vital. The other point with regards to development and our ability to be able to be sort of faced with less stress when it comes to kind of funding being available from federal government is again absolutely right. We've kind of exhausted the last tranche of those things now. In some respects, what we do develop had to be informed by this process, so we understood what the priorities were for us to take forward. So we kind of, again, just emphasising the need for us to be in that position, we need to get on and spend some money in relation to development. It is an unfortunate tension that rail schemes are complex and take a long time to develop, and unfortunately quite expensive even in their kind of early stages. But you get the longer term benefits when those things are actually delivered and provided they can be funded.
Alan? Yeah, thanks. This is a long term question and it is very, very parochial. Talking about this Dummersdale link and how it affects Rainford, when I took these plans to the people of Rainford, my colleagues and others, they were over the moon that in time they will have a better service into Liverpool. They weren't over enamoured about the link to Wigan, because although they will have more trains, the journey time will take longer because the trains are going through Skelmersdale, or they're going into Skelm out again. Is it possible to consider, and I'm only saying consider, that instead of having the two trains an hour going from Rainford through Skelm into Wigan, could we have three? Could we consider three by taking a third one coming directly from the Wigan direction into Rainford without touching Skelm, turning around at Rainford and going back. Now the thing there is, if we can't have that every hour through the day, is it possible at rush hour? Because we have a lot of the young people leaving Rainford for
in the Wigan area. I appreciate the point you're making, actually. It doesn't just come up at Skelm, it doesn't come up on Roger and some networks. First, one of the examples. What we can look at that, we're at a very early stage of the project. And the actual link between, the current link between Kirby and Wigan will still exist because freight trains are going to be operating. That type of service, so it's not going to be taken up in any way. It still focuses at the moment the budget on services to Skelmersdale and out of Wigan, but there's no reason why we can't look at alternative service patterns. It can be done as a desktop exercise. It can be done relatively cheaply, so we will pick that up as part of the process. We have meetings with Lancashire County on a regular basis. Two levels, as a high level overview and also the detail of the project, so we can take that to them. I'm aware that Nosey will be invited to sit on the board meetings in the future, so I'd probably be Sean Taylor actually will be invited to actually sit on the board meetings, so we'll be able to input directly, but we can definitely take that up. I can't guarantee what will come out of it, what sort of service pattern will be finalised, because it's just running the odd train, especially in the peak hour when resources are constrained. It can be quite a difficult situation, but it's something we can look at.
Can I just come back? Yeah, just a quickie on that. You know, people would think, well, we're coming home from Wigan, we're getting within a couple of hundred yards, say, of Rainford, and then we're turning off and we're going into the stem. That's not a thing, if you see my point.
I can completely. One of the other things is, you don't know what the timetable looks like at the moment. So and it depends how you get from actually Skelmersdale to Wigan as well. I mean, we mentioned the possibility of battery power on the Merseyrail units. I would certainly be a Merseyrail unit into Skelmersdale, which is considered probably the rail at the moment. But battery power does take off. You could run it with battery power and perhaps actually run the Merseyrail service through to Wigan. It's a possibility. I'm not saying it will happen, but these are all options. What you get then is the benefit of the higher speed of the Merseyrail trains, which actually reduce the journey time in a different way. So there's different ways of looking at it. What I would say at this point is that there isn't a hard and fast proposal to put in front of you, but we'll certainly keep in mind the comments you've made.
Thank you very much, Ben.
There we go. Got Natalie and Patrick.
Thank you, Chair. Thanks very much for this report. Just page 17, item 4.1 and 4.2. If you can clarify, please, in terms of, it indicates the funding constraints associated with the delivery of the strategy to be considered in full. However, in terms of human resource, it says none.
Yeah, where it refers to the human resource side, it is specifically to do with the report and the production of the strategy. Each of the individual projects within the strategy, as they take forward, will clearly have their own specific implications and will be picked up as we go forward. So it's not something we're ignoring, but for this phase of the work, there's no specific implications.
Patrick. Thank you, Chair. Some really interesting developments here. All these developments are kind of based on the principles of utilitarianism, and that is that we deliver the greatest benefit to the greatest number of people. However, in that process, there are victims, unfortunately. In the minority, those people who may live quite close to where these developments are taking place. It's a plea, really. Can we ensure, going forward, on all of these projects, where people who live close to the development are impacted, that contractors or the stakeholders or people we work with, we hold their feet to the fire to ensure that they actually do what they're supposed to do, and that's communicate effectively in a timely way to inform local residents of changes or other impacts that may affect their way of life. Yes, come back on that.
Thank you, Chair. Yes, thank you, Councillor. You're absolutely right. I'm guessing a lot of your comments are alluding to the development of the north and some of the challenges we have there. I think it's probably fair to say that we're very disappointed. I think we have to shoulder some of the responsibility for what has happened there, as well as laying the blame at that network around the contractors' doors, so we won't share that. We perhaps should have been better foreseeing that this situation may have arisen. It's certainly not what we would have expected from Network Rail. I mean, one of the things that Network Rail pride themselves on a national basis is their ability to be able to engage with their line side neighbours, and then appear in a situation where they've done anything but that. Our understanding was that there were letters that were due to those residents that weren't sent out that should have been. So there's this kind of single failure to take ownership in relation to taking forward this issue. We are aware of the concerns that have been raised. We have some actions in place, including both internal discussions this week, but also there's a residents' meeting which is planned for the 14th at the Town Hall. It is most definitely a sharp lesson to be learned fairly quickly, and something that will make sure that we get a greater profile to what we go for and for more.
I'm just in a sort of sense, I think we've had a great debate discussion around this and some really good points and some very good practical amendments raised. That on my desk I keep a copy of the Merseyside Local Transport Plan from 1972. And the reason I keep that on my desk is because it's a wonderful visionary document, wonderful to flip through and see the kind of far-sightedness of our forebears. However, it's a very sort of salutary reminder that much of it was never delivered. And the reason I sort of made that reference now is one of the things I think we should be really proud of is the strategy that we launched just 3 years ago. We're already getting on and delivering. You know, if you look at parts of the covering report, page 16 of it, of the 12 different strands we identified 3 years ago, five of them we're already on with. This is a 30-year strategy. We're already getting stuck into the delivery phase. Because strategies and glossy brochures are wonderful, but it's actually making sure they're delivered upon and they make a difference for the people that we serve. So it's really good where we're already up to 3 years into this. But obviously, one of the things we always committed to when we launched this in 2014 was that we would constantly review the strategy to make sure it was accurate, make sure it was contemporary, make sure it was deliverable. Because we don't have that crystal ball. We don't know what life will be like in 30 years' time. We've got a good idea, a forecast, we've got a lot of expectations, but things will change. So by reviewing it, we make sure that kind of it remains contemporary and something that we can deliver. And I think it's great what's coming out of this. Already things like the focus on Liverpool Central, it's already a massively busy station, vital for the city, but the wider city region. But crucially, we know going to have to do more work on that because it's where the vast majority of services come together. And if we want to see more services on things like the Bidston Wrexham line, extending out to places like Warrington, Skelmersdale and many other places, we've actually got to make sure we can accommodate them when they come into the city and they pass through. So it's really important that we've already sort of highlighted that. Great to hear all the different interests that we've got from many people about stations in their own patches as well. So it will be really good when we get that report back next meeting or the meeting after, we get into the nitty-gritty of, you know, what future stations development could look like. But I think the most important bit as well is that this is ambitious, but it's altogether realistic. It does point out how delivering railway schemes ain't easy and isn't always cheap. So I think we're actually kind of being very, very focused on what we can deliver, making sure we're ambitious, but making sure that we're not selling false promises. And what we've got in here, over the decades to come, we can start slotting it, and it will make a real difference. So in total, much done, but still a lot more to do. So with all of that, with all the necessary amendments and different points that people have raised, if we can agree the recommendations in paragraph 2 of the report. Excellent. Okay, item 5 is High Speed 2, and it's the Crew Hub consultation response, and Tom's going to take this one for us.
Good afternoon, Transport Committee members. I'm here today to ask you to note the content of the report with regards to the High Speed 2 Crew Hub consultation, and to note the content of the actual consultation response we provided to government. Just to give you an overview on what Crew Hub is, the government working with Network Rail, High Speed 2 Limited and relevant local authorities in the Crewe area have come up with an idea to redevelop the existing Crewe station to make it suitable for the future, including the provision of High Speed 2 services. They've also proposed a series of additional junctions in and around the Crewe area to create additional capacity both for High Speed 2 and conventional rail services. Now, clearly, Crewe is a very important location on the rail network, particularly for our part of the world. It's one of the first gateways, if you like, before we head further south on trains from the city region. And so Merseyside Travel felt it was incredibly important to provide a robust and evidence response to government on those points that we supported, but also those points we weren't so happy with. Now, the summary of our response is that we do not disagree with government proposals for stopping more HS2 trains at Crewe. Nor the principle of splitting trains, which they have introduced to their new plans. However, their initial consultation suggests that the trains to be split and to be joined back up again are Liverpool Power Services, which potentially has a journey time penalty to trains coming in and out of Liverpool and for Runcorn 2. Now, Liverpool, as part of the current proposals for HS2, will already be lagging behind other cities of a similar distance away from London. Examples are Leeds, Manchester, and even Wigan and Preston, much smaller conurbations than ourselves, will receive drastically improved journey times compared to Liverpool and Runcorn. So in our response to government, we made it quite clear that we do not support proposals that involve changing or splitting, joining rather, of all of the Liverpool Town services. We want to see a better offer than what we have currently, not a worse one. We also have highlighted that any plans that involve crew, with it being a major rail freight hub, need to allow for the fact that rail freight growth is coming from the Liverpool City region, both from the port of Liverpool and also from the terminals in South Liverpool and Halton that are there already, and some of which are already expanding. We've also inferred information around the links to Northern Powerhouse Rail and how that could potentially offer a much improved link for the Liverpool City region to High Speed 2 and onwards towards the West Midlands and London. And some of the proposals within the group up consultation do help support us in trying to achieve those aims. That's a very brief summary. We are expecting to have more dialogue with central government over these matters, and particularly we will continue to lobby to try and strengthen the offer that government have provided so far.
Thanks for that, Tom. Any questions or comments? Thank you, Chair. Thanks, Tom.
I noticed in your response one of the themes that kind of emerges is that Liverpool doesn't get its own spur, inherited disadvantage compared to other cities. And for a while I've been trying to encourage Liverpool to take a self-interested position against HS2 for that reason, because it does put us at a disadvantage in the power for a while to push your pace. So that aside, I noticed one thing you mentioned is that one of the issues is the need to increase capacity on the West Coast main line. Could that be done
cheaper conventional rail? Could there just be an additional track width of conventional rail, thus doubling capacity, for example, to have the HS2? Thank you, Councillor. It's fair to say that Network Rail and other government agencies for quite some time have been looking to try and increase capacity on the West Coast Main Line, which are main routes towards the south. Their conclusions in various studies, actually one of which I did when I was still at Network Rail, was that you are no better off doing anything on the West Coast Main Line. High Speed 2 is most certainly the best answer, because not only does it provide new railway for new trains, it also releases capacity so we can make better use of the West Coast Main Line. The biggest problem we have on our railways generally, particularly for our city region facing outwards, is that we don't have many tracks yet. We have a very wide array of different speeds of trains. We've got very slow freight trains, stopping passenger services which are essential for local connectivity, but also those higher speed regional and city services that allow commuters and businesses to work in other parts of the country. And we're trying to fit all that on very small bits of railway with old style signalling. And really what we need is between HS2 and Network Rail, basically a big uplift in investment and the amount of capacity that is available for us to lobby the services for improvements for the people of the city region. So as much as we could probably get on a lot sooner with improving the West Coast Main Line, we support the government's ideas around High Speed 2, and it also helps us achieve our ambitions for Northern Powerhouse Rail with quicker links east and west as well.
Thank you. I'm very to look forward again. I can see there's a lot of work to go into doing this. It's difficult sometimes when the questions that you're asked to come, always have the opportunity to put in there, but you'd like to say, I'm very frustrated and I have to do it. Just in terms of the economy, and you referred to the visitor economy and the importance of taking account of the people who are involved. Policy is about read throughout, but you don't, like I said earlier, you don't explicitly refer to this group of people. We get forgotten about. So if I don't know if it's too late to adjust it out for future reference, that should always be read in there. And in the actual report to the committee where it says there's no implications, there are implications. That's a sentence I don't want to see anymore. It's almost like it's one. Is that in the template that answer? Because it just comes up so often. It should never ever be there. Because if there really are no implications, then we need to know why not. But I think that all in this report, so I think it needs a bit more careful thought.
Thank you very much for those comments. We'll definitely take them into account when we write future reports. I think that's incredibly important. Also, in terms of ensuring accessibility to the network is a threat through all our future work, particularly in relation to emerging plans for ISPT, we'll definitely make sure that's in there as well. The response has already been submitted to government. It was submitted halfway through last month. So we don't have an opportunity to change it now, but we'll make sure in any future discussions we have with government and other relevant agencies that will we'll ensure that accessibility to the network and providing for all members of society is included in those discussions.
I think just to add to that as well, I do know that the director has agreed a work programme of how to kind of just strengthen that whole approach and make sure that kind of that sentence that you don't like, you don't see in carbon copy form ever again. Let's put it that way. I've now got Tony as well.
Thanks, Chair. Thanks, Tom. Yeah, it's a good response. I'm just looking at the people before, obviously. That's the one I read up before. That it doesn't hinder the growth of freight traffic. Now, HS2 plans, I assume, are all out there now anyway, what the full plan is. Forgive me for my ignorance, what would hinder the projects going on at Liverpool? So if Liverpool Freight can't get out, how would HS2 either remedy it or hinder it?
Thank you for the question. So in terms of hindering it, it's a lot about choices. So the organisation responsible for developing the true hub could easily try to prioritise passenger services to other parts of the country rather than freight services. So part of our lobbying effort is to ensure that we first of all flag that freight coming out of Liverpool is going to be growing, whether they like it or not, it's going to happen. But also to ensure we have the evidence to back those statements up. The team here, particularly in the policy team, are doing an awful lot of work to develop that evidence and work quite closely with the ports. But like I say, we'll bring it into account the long-term rail strategy as well. We clearly have, in some areas, competing needs between freight and passenger, and that's something that we try and come up with the most optimal solution at every time. But clearly, the port is a key asset. Terminals in South Liverpool and in Halton are also key assets for the city region, particularly from an employment perspective. What we don't want is the lack of freight paths on the wider network penalising firms and the people of the city region.
Chairman, I find it very disrespectful for this committee for two meetings to be going on.
Can we just end that conversation in the corner? Tim?
Yeah, just, is it worth emphasising to government with regards to this, of the angles that were taken to Brexit and so on and so forth, on world trade, on where we're positioned within that world trade, logistically throughout the country, and what's likely to, where the trade's going to come in for the whole of the UK. It's not only important that these freight lines are left open, it's crucial to the economy for the whole UK.
I couldn't agree more with that point. One thing to reference as well is the City Region's freight strategy that the Combined Authority have been working on of late, and they've also been working very closely with Transport for North in development of their own freight and logistics strategy. We, as officers between Mercy Travel and the Combined Authority, are working incredibly hard to push that message. The thing is, I guess, that the more prosperity we have here, the more schemes that us guys can go on and deliver, so it keeps us in the job, basically. So it's in our interests to ensure that all these things are going.
And I'll just sort of follow up on that, just to sort of particularly pay tribute to the whole directing, particularly Tom, because not just this report, we've been working really hard on this whole agenda for a long time. We've had him come into transport for the North for us to basically kind of make sure that our arguments were fully understood and making sure that all the detailed work was being done. And he's done a fantastic job with all of that. Yeah, genuinely, when you think about the announcement that the government did make about passing provision for a junction to Liverpool off HS2, that is in no small part down to the great work the whole of the rail team, particularly Tom, has done within sort of transport for the North. So thanks ever so much. I think we're really lucky that we've got a team of experts that we have fighting on this agenda. Still a lot more to do, but I'm confident we'll get there. Can I then move the recommendation in paragraph 2 of the report, if that's agreed?
Agreed.
Excellent. Item 6 is public question time. We don't actually have any questions that have come to the committee today. We did have a number of questions that were asked about issues regarding horse riding and the relevance to the City Region Road Strategy. Because the City Region's Road Safety Strategy went through the Combined Authority a few months ago, we thought it was more appropriate to direct those questions to the next Combined Authority meeting. So those questions will go to the Combined Authority and the people that ask those questions, because they're very important, very sort of relevant issues. I've been informed that that's where those questions will go to. So we've had those in accordingly. Item 7 is petitions and statements, and likewise we haven't received any petitions and statements for this meeting. And the final item is any other urgent business approved by myself. There's nothing urgent other than it being remiss of me not to sort of mention that Liz Chandler, our Director of Corporate Development, is not with us today. Liz is convalescing after a recent operation. She's doing really well. We're looking forward to seeing her when she's back in her full fitness. But if we can send our best wishes for her speedy recovery, And with all of that, thank you for your attendance. I look forward to seeing you at the meeting in December.